Hi friends, before we start today's video, I just wanted to say that there will be... This is Chip, by the way. This is a trigger warning. A trigger warning for ED, food issues, mental health issues, murder, conspiracies. There is a trigger warning basically for everything in this video. And I just want everyone to see that and hear that. And if you need any resources or any support or any help, I'm going to link down below some resources. And if anyone has any further resources, please link them down below. Channel recommendations, Instagram recommendations, professional advocacy advice, everything like that that I have missed, please link it down below. And this video might be a little rambly, it might be a little long, but it is, I'm basically giving you guys a full look at what I go through when it comes to putting out content. And I'm skipping all of those little things that I do on my own and wanted to have them with you guys. So let's get straight into it. And welcome to my very awkward intro. My name is Susan / Bambi and this is Bambi's Rambles. How are we, friends? Are we good? That's good. And if you're not okay, that's okay too. I just realized for that entire intro I was looking at the viewfinder and I'm still doing it now. Okay, so hopefully you guys have seen the start of the video where I talked about trigger warnings and resources and all these different things that will be linked in the description down below. Be mindful of that when sharing this video, that to let people know that there are resources and there are information down below. And yeah, let's get into it. So the way this video came about was, obviously a lot of us in the commentary community are talking about Eugenia Cooney. And I have a habit, I don't know what it is, but I have a habit of talking about people and then 3-4 months later, it's a big thing and everyone's talking about it. And I made my first Pastel Belle, Belle Aubrey, whatever name she goes by now, Toaster Belle, I don't know, who knows, whatever, I don't care. I made that video because I felt as though I was doing the right thing. I felt like I was standing up for someone like Eugenia, who is going through something, who is mentally unwell. And I don't say that disrespectfully, I say that with the most empathy and compassion that I can possibly have. That was my goal, right? And I was kind of aggressive and very, very firm in my thoughts because I had seen a video from a smaller YouTuber and I felt like they were a voice that I could, you know, platform a little bit and talk about and see their side. Anyway, so that was the beginning of why we have videos on Eugenia, from coming from me standing up for her or whatever it is, right? That's why I have those on my channel. Some of my thoughts have been influenced, I guess, from Willie Mack's content, the disagreements that I have with some of the past content of Sloane, the past content of Pastel Belle, my absolute disdain for Repzilla. All those things were something that, you know, I was looking into. Anywhoozle. I was having a conversation on a Discord that I'm in, with a few people who are creators, and someone brought a channel to my attention. One of my favorite starry people on the internet brought a channel to my attention, and I have been watching this channel for maybe the past 3 to 4 weeks, maybe a little bit more. I've been taking a lot of breaks from watching this channel, and I'll explain why in a minute. But this channel is called 50 Shades of Chest Pain. Before I go into this channel, I do want to say something. And again, I don't fucking control what people do on the fucking internet. You're all like adults and can do your own fucking thing, like decide what you want. But do not use my video to go and attack this person, to go and leave negative, mean, heart, like hurtful comments, all that sort of shit. Like just don't fucking do it. Don't do it. That's not my goal here. That's not what I want. I don't vibe with that shit, you know what I mean? If I want to fight with someone, I'll fight with them on my own. And most of the time I end up saying sorry because I'm a big fucking softy. Anyway, so I started watching this channel. Now, this channel is bizarre to me, okay? And I will go into this, and then I will go into what the rabbit hole I fell down with because of this channel. My ongoing conflicting thoughts and opinions on this channel, on this community, on this movement, and we'll figure it out, okay? I did say there's gonna be a long-winded one, but it's purely to show you guys like why I don't just fucking put videos out all the time on just random shit, because my mind is like, you're kind of reaching here, Bambles, like you're reaching, babe, like calm down, you know what I mean? And I don't want to reach for anything but cookies at this point. So anyway, so this person has a channel. They have nearly 3,000 subscribers. They used to do a lot of incel content, talking about the incel community and the crimes that have come from that, the death of people, the cult-like mentality, behavior, so on and so forth. So it kind of felt like this channel was doing a lot of analyzing human behavior, a bit of armchair psychology, which I don't have a problem with armchair psychology. Is that a hot take or something? Like, I don't have a problem with that. We should all talk about it. You know, if we're giving out negative stigmas, probably not the greatest thing, but it does open up a conversation. People can have that in the comment sections, you know. That's no skin off my nose type thing. Not my monkey, not my circus type vibe. But their content kind of shifted, and it shifted to talk about mainly e-celebrities or e-people, so internet people that have YouTube channels, Tumblr blogs, all those sorts of things. And it talks about, they talk about their journeys, right? Which okay. So the main focal point of the journey is their eating disorder. Whilst I think that Ari, who is the owner and narrator, creator of this channel, might have good intentions, they seem very intelligent, they seem to do their research, they seem to do a lot of, you know, those sorts of things, I don't like this channel, okay? And the reason why is we have very, very, very bizarre things being pointed out about this channel. And this is the thing, I'm just talking with you guys, like I'm not gonna get straight to the point here because I'm trying to like navigate what to say and what not to say, right? And one thing this person does is the titles of the videos, okay, are, if he's talking about an older woman with an ED who is not on the recovery side, like I don't want to say the wrong fucking thing here, man, but this person's not on the recovery side of things, in the title he's calling them vintage Eugenia Cooney or old Eugenia Cooney, or he's got videos on Eugenia Cooney where he talks about her mother and how her mother is most likely suffering from ED by proxy.
That causes a youth situation like Eugenia Cooney's is anorexia by proxy. I'm not saying what's going on with Eugenia Cooney is anorexia by proxy. I'm going to show how a situation like Eugenia Cooney's and her mother can be a result of anorexia by proxy. So I will be making frequent comparisons. To be completely frank, what I really think is going on with Eugenia Cooney is a lot of, as one of my commenters pointed out, many comorbidities, probably comorbidities among comorbidities. And probably all these comorbidities are operating in subsections of subsections of subsections of certain kinds of diagnoses. But even though Eugenia Cooney may not be a case of anorexia by proxy, definitely she does exemplify a lot of the outcomes of anorexia by proxy. I stumbled onto anorexia by proxy because Eugenia Cooney is typically compared to the Gypsy and Dee Dee Blanchard case. Gypsy and Dee Dee Blanchard are typically spoken about in regards to the case of Munchausen by proxy. Whether or not that was actually what was going on with them, they have become the face of the disorder. While I was looking up Munchausen by proxy, I wondered if anorexia can be a subsection of it, and I discovered there is such thing as anorexia by proxy. Going forward, when I talk about anorexia by proxy, I am going to use female pronouns in regards to mother and daughter and she and her, because that is who this most commonly affects. However, I will acknowledge that yes, this can also be between a father and son. Obviously, women aren't the only people who can be anorexic. Anorexia by proxy is very difficult to comprehend because there isn't really much about it. The overwhelming majority of the cases that we know about do consist of the mother being anorexic and passing it down to her daughter. There was only one academic study I could find in which the mother was not described as being anorexic. I will not be reading from that study because it is very badly written and there are other academic studies that do a better job of describing the disorder. In fact, I will be reading from another study that holds the case of the mother being anorexic, and it pretty much says all the same things that the study that doesn't talk about a mother's anorexia says also. When I found these articles, and one in particular, I thought I stumbled upon a fountain of information that was untapped, and then I realized Reddit beat me to it. So if you don't want to hear me talk, I'll link the Reddit forum to the same article I'll be reading from. The comments there pretty much say the same thing I'm going to say, but I do encourage you to stick around because I will be going into another piece of literature that's not on Reddit and that hasn't been talked about. So stay tuned for that.
Yes, ED by proxy. Now, I haven't done my due diligence and gone and searched this. I haven't. Because I just think it's the most bizarre thing in the world. We have videos where they talk about someone that went to a recovery center with a doctor, and this channel Ari went and searched and said this doctor is a snake oil salesman, he's all that in a bag of chips, but in a negative way, if that makes sense, and that this person is diagnosing and helping this ED sufferer with their anxiety and their sleep issues, when that shouldn't be the focus point, it should be the ED. Now, I'm not a fucking doctor, I ain't no genius, I'm dumb as a box of rocks, but from someone that has had a long history of struggling with mental health issues and the fact that I suffer quite a bit with insomnia. Sleep is the most important thing. If you don't have the proper sleep, you cannot process anything else. And from what I've seen when it comes to ED struggles and things like that, from what I've witnessed on the internet with the anorexia, ED, bulimia communities, like the recovery communities, is it's a long process, and it's a hard process. And the ED can sometimes be a coping mechanism for other things. So if you have anxiety and you can't sleep, sometimes your coping mechanism is this control or lack of control when it comes to food, right? So I was like, uncomfortable. And I have to take a step back from this channel. And I just think to myself, can I talk about this? Should I talk about this? Should I not talk about this? Am I helping anybody? Am I drawing more attention? Like, what am I doing? Okay. The thing that tipped me over the edge was the fact that I am at a stage of 50 shades, I don't understand. 50 shades of I don't understand. Like, I don't get it. I don't get it. Now, this person has on their latest video said that Eugenia is aggressively positive in their Instagram posts. I'm gonna try and insert clips here and there throughout this video so you kind of get where I'm coming from, not just like talking out of my ass. and that the algorithm of, fuck me dead, the algorithm of Tumblr, Instagram, YouTube, of the things she's showing is showing us and telling us that if she found this certain channel or this certain post or this certain stream, the algorithm is giving her that because deep down she's not actually positive. She knows she's withering away. She knows she's, and this person uses terms such as decaying and rotting and very, I feel is very shame-like language.
Everyone is lying to you, or are you normal? From the originator of that post is a Twitter account by @suicidalchrist, and that struck me as just so bizarre. It is just so depressing and dark, and I'm just like, what the hell? So a quick brief on Eugenia Cooney's social media lately. We all know she loves to repost and tweet positive affirmations, and they tend to have a very passive-aggressive tone that you could interpret as being geared towards her haters, like the Reddit, and people who just do not like her presence for many reasons, all of course related to her eating disorder. And it's interesting because, you know, one, if this was a one-off, it wouldn't be a big deal, but the fact that she constantly just floods her feed, or our feeds from her account with tons of aggressively positive posts, just comes off as a pushback to the negativity that she courts online, since she does actively court it intentionally. So, of course, pushing it, being super positive on her account, just comes off as a bit of a middle finger without actually saying so, because she wants to maintain the excuse that she just wants to be a super nice, positive person. And, okay, it's interesting because with a lot of the stuff that she reposts, I mean, on their own, they wouldn't be such a big deal, as I said. For example, a few days ago, she reposted this on her Instagram stories. I'll insert it here. And, I mean, it's very clear why she's drawn to that kind of stuff. But that came from an art account that is not pro-Anna at all. In fact, when I checked out the account, it's very popular. A friend of mine follows it, and Louis Tan from Mortal Kombat, he also follows it. So it's just a regular art account and all. And obviously that a piece of art of a skeleton with the angel wings isn't a problem on its own, but in the context of Eugenia liking it, then it gets a little bit sus, as people say nowadays. Is that a thing still? I don't know. And I mocked it. I reposted, I screen grabbed that last post of the skeleton with angel wings and Eugenia Cooney showing it on her Instagram stories. I put it on my community tab because I'm like, wow, wow. I mean, when it's related to her, it definitely has a whole other meaning, of course. So, but then we get to this, again, post that's just outright depressing, and that's very different than what she's normally posted, and all, and it's strange. It's a bit of a break from her regular stuff. So I checked out, because that's from reposted from another Instagram account, as what you usually do with Instagram stories. The Instagram account is interesting. It's called, I'm not sure how to call it, Chris Wifty, I'm not really sure, but anyway, the account, it's an anonymous account. It looks to be, well, a mix of a dark humor account and just plain dark, because it, most of it is just curated screen grabs of tweets, and a lot of the tweets and screen grabs are just either, like, dark humor, haha, look how depressing life is, or just, life is depressing. So let's go over some of them. Me, tired, stressed, exhausted, I wanna cry? Yes. You ever put on a fit so hard it's almost embarrassing? Just paid a bill, I can't keep doing this. And how do you get someone to unknow me? I no longer want to be known by these people. Girls be like, yeah, I'm okay. if I read anything more disturbing or show some of the disturbing pictures, then I feel like, you know, I can't upload the video. Just something else interesting to note about this suicidal Christ thing. I was looking through who follows it, and I did find one Pro-Anna account, which I think is just very interesting there. Okay, so now you've got an idea of, like, again, this very break in Eugenia Cooney's normal just regular repostings on Instagram stories to fill her time. But also, the last Instagram story of last night, November 1st, was also very interesting, and again, it wasn't like what you saw. I'll just show it here. She's screenshotting her computer, and it's, OMG, you guys, this is so random, but YouTube recommended me this 24/7 Disney piano music stream. It's so nice and relaxing, haha. No, it is not random. I instantly recognize what kind of channel that is. That is a sleep channel to help you fall asleep. So it's interesting because, actually, YouTube at one point was recommending to me literally the exact same thing. Well, not as that, but the kind of channel. The summertime was very stressful for me, and I was having a hard time sleeping, and I was just kind of skipping. I was stress clicking through videos, I guess you could call it. I was just kind of jumping from video to video, trying to find something to distract me from all the stresses that was preventing me from sleeping. And eventually, I think I tried to put in something, because, you know, most of my channels I'm subscribed to are, like, drama channels, like, very intense. I was looking for something less intense. I put in, like, I don't know, Cityscape and everything, City Walk, or City something, hoping to see, like, a travel video or something. And then YouTube recommended me, like, a, just, like, a, what is it? A rendering, animation rendering with, like, light rain on the window of, like, a quiet place, kind of. It's interesting. It's just basically like an ASMR to make you sleep. Basically, what was going on is YouTube could see I was up late and having a hard time sleeping because it could, the algorithm could read I was very stressed out because I was just going through video, not really watching any, just kind of only a little bit and then skipping to the next and the next, and then broke and then tried, then broke from the normal search criteria I was putting into the bar and just looking for something more calming, and instantly it recommended to me a fall asleep channel, even though I had never searched or watched for anything of the sort before and didn't even put sleep or sounds or anything like that in the search bar, because the terms that I was putting in for something more calming, like cityscape or train, because I like to watch trains that calm me down, those you would think would be like louder or would just be also exciting videos, but again, the algorithm knew, oh no, he's stressed, he can't distract himself properly, and he's up late at night, he needs to sleep. So it's interesting, and that's what's going on with her. Probably, she was up late at night, and again, stress-clicking, going through videos, and if she didn't, she could have maybe put something in to help her sleep, or something more calming-related, like calm Disney princess fairy noises, I don't know. But likely what happened was, because it's a late hour, likely what the algorithm saw is she was kind of jumping from Disney video to Disney video, and then recommended this, which is Disney-related, which would be more calming. Because the algorithm does read when you're kind of stressed out based on your watch habits and your search habits and how quickly you're going through. So, and you think, well, hold on, no, that is related because she's so Disney-obsessed, that's related to rest for content. The YouTube channel, which is called K&O Music, it says in the description, it's a sleep channel. I'll just read it here. K&O Music will take you to the soothing and relaxing world to deliver you the final. That's just very interesting. I really have to wonder if there's something going on in her life that we don't know about that is stressing her out. Because these recent posts indicate she's going through something, that there's an escalated level of stress that obviously we would not be shown. But just by, again, what her social media algorithms are beginning to show her that she's drawn to that's different than the rest, it indicates there's a shift in her general mood.
And also the titles, those type of references, give me the opinion, me, just Bambi over here, that this person views eating disorders as something to out someone on or have gossip about. I could be wrong. Tell me I'm wrong. That's fine. I just feel like some of these clips, some of these claims, some of these titles are... Let me just pull up the channel and I'll read some of the titles for you. Okay, so we have... Ashley Isaacs, Anorexia's Fallen Angel. Anorexilaza, the Sandy Hook shooter, used anorexia as a mental mutation. Thinnerella, when anorexia is guarded by a palace. Like, I don't know if if I'm being extra in how I view these titles. Is this a, I don't know, a video is titled The Science of Eugenia Cooney's Decaying Body. Why Eugenia Cooney loves Jack Skellington so much. Tumblr is the life of a pro-Anna utopia. Manorexic. I don't know, like there's just so much here that just is very, very, very uncomfortable. Thinnessence, inside the minds of parents who want anorexic children. Now, that video is what I was talking about earlier. It was comparing Dee Dee Blanchard and Gypsy Rose to Eugenia Cooney and her mother. And I just found that bizarre. I just found it so bizarre, so bizarre, so bizarre. But this person says that they've never struggled with an ED. They have two interests basically, and their interests are true crime and eating disorders. Is that a level of fetishizing? I can't say that word, I apologize. Is that a level of that? Is that not a level of that? Am I reaching with that? I don't know. You know, there's a lot of layers there of what I'm trying to like figure the fuck out with this fucking channel. Because this young man appears to be well-spoken, well-educated, intelligent, but the erotic thrill of being sickly thin. Like, just, I don't know, man. I just don't understand. It just is very, very odd to me. Very, very odd to me. And it makes me very, very uncomfortable. Now, okay, we're gonna keep it pushing. So once I was looking at all this sort of stuff, I was sitting there and I was like, who the fuck am I to talk about this? Because whilst I have had issues with food, and I have had issues with my own self-esteem, my own issues, my own everything. I was brought up in an Italian household where my extended family on my mother's side would call me Annie. They would call me Annie because I was very, very, very thin. Very, very, very thin. I was very, very picky with foods. I didn't like to eat. I hid my foods behind my refrigerator and my mum would lose it because then we'd have ants in the house and all this craziness. And I'm currently going through my own situation right now where you see me here, this is my body, and I feel as though I'm incredibly heavy, and that makes me very upset. But I've never had the overwhelming struggle of an eating disorder. And I just want to put this little section in here. This video is also an apology to somebody. And owning my choices, actions, self as well. So that will be at the end of the video, just so you know. But anyhoozle, I was like, okay, I'm going to go find out what other people think. People that actually can really have an educated say in this sort of stuff, which is people that are in recovery, and who are promoting recovery-based content, and have like real fucking opinions and a real say and in this, because they have been through it or are currently going through it. So I fell down that rabbit hole. And the rabbit hole I fell down started off with a channel, What Mia Did Next. Now, Mia is an Aussie like me, so I vibe very much with the way that she spreads her message. That might be slightly a bias here. There might be people in the ED community that don't vibe with her, that don't get her, that don't understand why I would enjoy her and her content. But she is a fully recovered ED sufferer who also is a public advocate for EDs. They speak publicly to the media and have rallies and fundraisers, and they talk about that they are a coach and they work day in, day out with ED strugglers, survivors, and they talk a lot about all these different things in regards to recovery and how we can be more understanding people that are not actually dealing with this illness, right? How we can understand more, how we can advocate more. And the first video I watched of hers was where she was talking about, everything will be linked down below, but she was talking about how she does not, her unpopular opinion when it comes to ED, pro-Anna content. Now I was watching that, and basically the beginning of their journey was they hated it, they wanted it gone, they were advocating for removal, all those sorts of things. Then the dust settled, everything settled, they took accountability for their own actions, their own choices, their own, you know, seeking that sort of environment and behavior. But they also said something very, very interesting, where imagine the position that people with eating disorders are in, where they feel that they need a community of like-minded people who understand them. And imagine taking that away. And that to me was enough for me to say, well, I don't have a say in getting rid of ED, pro-Anna content, forums, things like that. I had no say in that. If people, if a woman that works with ED strugglers, survivors every single day and does advocacy and studies and all these sorts of things on it is telling us that we need to focus our resources, energy, anger, all these sorts of things away from removing pro-Anna stuff to having more understanding, resources, funding, all these other things for people that need and want to get help. They don't feel so isolated. They don't feel so much shame. And when they go to these places, they have that acceptance and understanding. They can go anywhere else and say, I'm really struggling here, can you help me? Or, oh my God, this person's struggling too and they want to get better, maybe I should get better. Do you get what I'm saying? Anyway, that was one of the first videos I saw. And I was like, okay, I can vibe with that. Like, I get it, it makes sense to me. Whereas there's the other side where they do have these conflicting thoughts and feelings, and a lot of people in the community also have this, where there is the sad reality that people are getting help to get worse. Tips and tricks to enhance their eating, distorted eating patterns and behaviors. Do you get what I'm saying? So it's too layered, and I get that. So then I went off and watched another video of Mia's, where Mia is talking about Eugenia Cooney and how they've had the same stance for years, but they made it more direct in this video.
Eugenia Cooney to come up with ideas or strategies for being able to save her. I first and foremost want to say I so appreciate the genuine care and concern behind those requests and behind a lot of people's intentions within, you know, the wider YouTube community to try to reach and help Eugenia. I think it's really beautiful. I think some of it's misguided and naive, but I think the genuine care is wonderful and an energy we could really use in eating disorder awareness spaces for sure. Of course, there are the cynical kind of uses of Eugenia, and there's quite a bit of that, but it's certainly not the majority from what I've seen. So I just want to acknowledge that before I fairly bluntly say what I have to say and have said in former videos, but maybe I haven't said it this bluntly before. So I think that, as I've stated previously, a lot of the attempts to help Eugenia are naive. The majority of people, even if you've had a lived experience of an eating disorder, could never understand Eugenia's specific situation. We just can't. I'm someone, for context, who recovered from anorexia binge purge subtype years ago and have been working with eating disorder recovery clients as a coach for the last 3.5 years. I've helped people to fully recover. It's the greatest joy of my life. It also gives me some insight. It doesn't give me insight into Eugenia's specific situation. Point one. Eating disorders are super, super complex just in and of themselves on their own. They are one of the most complicated psychiatric illnesses. And I can tell you from both sides of the fence, someone who was in one and someone who helps to treat them from the outside, they're really, 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 really hard to overcome. They can be overcome, absolutely. I believe that that is absolutely the truth and they can be fully overcome. But it's hard work. It's really, really, really hard. And it's made harder based on our support system, based on our particular mental health challenges outside of the eating disorder. We may have anxiety, we may have depression, there may be comorbidities. It's made more difficult depending on our access to treatment, our family situation, our home situation. There are so many different variables which make recovery that much more challenging, which we can see with Eugenia. But as far as the mental illness itself, it is not just about food. It is not just about the body. For a lot of people, it's a coping mechanism in response to trauma, in response to abuse, in response to bullying that they may have experienced. It could be a combination of all of those things. For some people, it's a coping mechanism because of comorbidities with other mental illnesses or physical illnesses. They are so, so complicated. We don't just feed people and restore their health and go, you're done. These things can take years to recover from because they are mental illnesses with physical symptoms. And all we're doing is commenting on her physical symptoms. That's not what the real struggle is. That's not where the real work is done. So that's the first thing. Eating disorders are seriously complicated, and unless you have walked in the shoes or you understand their mechanisms and how they operate, they are very, very, very hard to empathize with. They are, because you can't understand the upside down nature of the world that you live in when you're in an eating disorder. The second complication with the Eugenia scenario is her, as I understand it, from what I do know, from what you guys have told me, what I've tried to verify, she has a seriously, seriously complicated home life, family life, and therefore support system. Even if Eugenia, which she has stated repeatedly, flat out denial that there is even a problem and that she needs or wants help or has any intention of pursuing help, even if she was open to it, the nature of her support system and her home life would make that extremely challenging. Not impossible, but extremely challenging. Now, point one and point two are things that we can all kind of understand, right? We can all kind of put ourselves in that headspace. I can. I certainly can. I recovered living out of home as a 25-year-old, had to do a lot of the legwork, for want of a much better phrase, myself, making myself eat, making myself go to appointments, making myself do the work every day was really up to me. So it can be done. Obviously, the difference being I had wonderful support from afar, but the day-to-day, that was up to me. What none of us can understand, what I will even never understand, is her third complication, which is that this is all happening on the internet. She is going through a severe and chronic eating disorder on the internet with a crusade of people hating, helping, being concerned, leaving comments, disliking her videos, starting up entire Reddit forums. I'm too old. I don't know how Reddit works. I'll be totally transparent with you. I've had this stuff sent to me. Tracking her every move, her appearance, how she looks from this angle and that angle. Do you know what eating disorders do? That. The way the community is analyzing and deconstructing and pulling apart and some abusing and some, you know, jumping up with concern. That's what eating disorders.
Basically saying that helping Eugenia is frivolous, pointless, harsh words, I know. Let me explain. Basically saying that right now, everything that's being mirrored to Eugenia is everyone talking about her appearance, okay? Everyone is either saying, you look great, don't change anything, or they're sending all the hate in the world. You're sick, you're this, you're all these sorts of things. All that is doing for Eugenia is like fulfilling the thoughts that her ED gives her, which is, everyone focuses on my appearance. My appearance is paramount. Like, that is my focus, goal, everything, because everybody else is focused on it the same way I am, and it's just mirroring all the thoughts, feelings, opinions that she has back on her. And that blew my mind. I was like, wow, okay. So what is the right way to help Eugenia? And some people were saying, you know, to take her off the internet. Well, that there in itself, okay, she's not going to get the positive, she's not going to get the negative, she just has to live within her own world. That's too layered too, isn't it? You're taking away her happiness, her creativity, her finances, and pushing her into this dark place. But then you are taking away all of those comments. So I get it, but it's still not going to help her. And this has been going on for years, where people have been talking about her eating disorder, her and all these other, you know, channels and people and stuff like that. And what has it actually done? It's literally done nothing. It hasn't. Like, if you really think about it, she does not seem to be getting better. And I hate to even focus on her appearance. I do, because I know that is, like, if she ever saw this video, it'd be uncomfortable for her. And also, like, what is it doing for the bigger picture, right? Like, as I was saying about Mia's channel, Mia and educating Shani, who I'll talk about in a minute, both said a lot of the same sentiments when it comes to shame, okay? And that shame is a large part, and if I'm saying this incorrectly, I truly apologize. I'm literally going off my own interpretation of the videos that I have watched, and if I'm wrong, correct me. Like, I'm, you know, it's all gravy. Is basically saying that shame is a big part of it, okay? So if we are on the internet and we're saying Eugenia Cooney is doing all of these things to people by her content, she is causing ED, she's doing all this stuff, yada yada yada, we're shaming her. And not only are we shaming her, we're shaming other people that have eating disorders that maybe don't want to come and talk about it anymore, because they're like, look at how they fucking treated Eugenia. Causing more shame, which causes more issues within yourself, which causes, could heighten in distorted food behaviors and so on and so forth, right? And I was like, okay, this isn't helping. Then we go to the other thing that everybody is saying, which is she's causing people to have an ED. Now, again, I was talking about educating Shani, and I'll talk about her in a minute, because her view is a bit different to this view, to Mia's view, and they're in the same community. So Mia's view on this is that an eating disorder is very, very, very layered, okay? And seeing someone such as Eugenia is not necessarily just going to put someone in the grips of an eating disorder. There are things that are underlying inside of yourself, certain traumas, emotions, mental health concerns, so on and so forth, that are already inside of yourself. They're already there. We're just waiting for that one little brick to bring it to the surface. And if that ends up being Eugenia Cooney, her content, well, she can't necessarily be blamed for that, because all the issues that you had before have just come to the surface from this. Do you know what I mean? Like, they were already there. Everything was already there. A lot of people focus on seeing a skinny person is going to give someone an ED. Whilst that can trigger things and can trigger recovery, can trigger a lot of things, that's not your number one fucking thing that causes you to feel this way. Does that make sense? So anyway, I learned that through watching some of Mia's content. Now, I didn't just want to get one point, like one person's view. I ended up on Educating Shani 2.0's channel. Educating Shani is absolutely adorable. I cannot. She is adorable. She is quirky. She is funny. And I really enjoy her vibes. Honestly, I really, really do. And she has a very different look at this. So she was sharing Eugenia Cooney content. And not only that, she was also sharing videos of people that have been sent to her saying that Eugenia Cooney caused their eating disorder. Sorry, my camera died. Anyway, she found that sharing Eugenia Cooney content was helping to not give Eugenia Cooney a view. And she had heard through the Twitter grapevine, the Twitch grapevine, I don't know, whatever one it was, that Eugenia does watch her content. So she was feeling as though, okay, if she's watching my content, what can I do? And she decided to take the more aggressive route, which was to show her content so she didn't get a view, to also show people, not only like telling Eugenia what her content has done to them, but berating her, yelling at her. Someone called her a stupid something or other. She's apologized for that. That was removed from the video, so on and so forth. And she basically said, okay, do you want me to show this or not? Because she was called out by Mia about it. And she had 75% of her audience say, keep showing.
Hey guys, I messed up. Weeks ago, I started making videos about Eugenia Cooney, and particularly, I started reacting to her videos. Every time she put up a video, I would react to it on my channel in hopes that I could bring her audience to my channel and not give her a view, because in my opinion, her views and her comments and her likes and dislikes and all of that that goes towards her channel and her money and everything is what is feeding into her disorder. And most of you agreed with me. I also absolutely had the intent of bringing her followers to my channel so that they could see a pro recovery channel. I'm grateful for all the people that came from her channel to my channel, and I'm grateful that I've been able to help so many of you new people and so many of you old people. I'm so grateful for that. But with my platform comes a really, really big responsibility that I started to overlook. I made a video talking directly to Eugenia Cooney, telling her how I felt, telling her what I loved about her and that I was worried for her. She then made a response video to me that validated to me that she watches my videos. And this isn't the first time I've heard that. I know she's watched other videos as well. I know that she's talked about me before as well. And I got excited and I thought to myself, oh my goodness, Eugenia watches my videos. Okay, what do I need to say? I really need to think this through. Like, what's going to help her the most and what's going to get through to her? Because of course I wanted to try and get through to her. We all do. We all did. We all wanted to try. And so many people tried so many different things, and I hadn't heard of anybody trying this approach where we take away temporarily the support of her channel so that she would hopefully go and get some help, because maybe that was the only way she could get her people back someday. I know that that's out there, and I know that a lot of you don't agree with it. I know most of you actually did agree with me, but that was kind of my intent with those videos. My channel started to grow really quickly. I was getting thousands and thousands of new subscribers, and I was so excited, and I was so happy, and I felt so good. I felt like I was doing such a good thing, and then I started to try and listen to my new audience. My new audience brought a lot of new ideas to the table that I wanted to try, and so did my old audience, and I wanted to keep on following what they wanted me to do. Again, I'm not blaming them for this. Just stay with me for a minute. A couple years ago, my channel was going downhill. I got really sick. I was relapsing every 5 seconds. I was messing up every 5 seconds. I was not very good at making videos. I was not staying consistent, and I was not progressing. I was not progressing in my eating disorder. And during that time, I lost a lot of people. I lost a lot of subscribers, and it kind of made me realize that what I was doing was not okay, and that I needed to get myself better in order to get my friends back. So I did. I got myself better, and I got my friends back. I got my subscribers back. I got everything back. So of course I was excited when all my subscribers started to go up, even though most of them probably came from Eugenia's channel. It still fulfilled that thing in me, like, oh, maybe I'm finally doing something right, so maybe I should keep doing it. So in several videos, I would ask my audience, do you guys want me to keep reacting to Eugenia Cooney? And everybody kept on saying yes. Not everybody, but the majority kept saying yes. And then one day there was a video sent to me about a girl named Claire, and she's so freaking adorable. I love you, Claire, if you're watching. And she posted a video about how Eugenia Cooney affected her eating disorder and contributed to it. Not caused, just contributed. And I thought she was so well-spoken and she was so beautiful, and I is not being
100% kind or 100% fair to me, then they must be right and Mia must be wrong. And so I think that also contributed to my, do I continue with this Eugenia stuff or do I not? I got really caught up, and this is my bad, I should not have done that. I really got caught up in the drama of it and thought to myself, well, I'm not gonna do what Mia would tell me to do because I'm angry with her because of the things that were said about me. I was completely wrong. That is so immature. That is so fifth grade of me. I don't know what I was thinking. That was out of line. And I'm so sorry to my audience, to everybody out there. I am so sorry. And I'm so sorry to Eugenia for doing this. I'm so sorry if what I did hurt you. Eugenia, I'm terribly sorry. I promise you, I'm going to be working on this to make sure that I'm doing the right thing moving forward and not getting caught up in drama and not getting caught up in other things on the internet. A couple of days ago, I posted a video saying that I was conflicted on whether or not I should leave Eugenia's videos up and whether I should keep on reacting to the videos or showing them on my channel so that people would not want to give her another view. I knew, I kind of figured and knew that the majority of you would say to keep on doing it because that's how it's been this entire process, as most of you have wanted me to do this. So I took the vote, and I would say at least 75, maybe 80% of you said, yes, please keep showing her videos and react to them, please. So at this point, I started getting a little bit of a weird feeling in my gut about maybe like I had done enough, maybe I had done enough about Eugenia and maybe it was time to stop, but I kept going. So I made a video last night where I reacted to Eugenia's latest video addressing the rumors, where I surprisingly agreed with a lot of what she said, or at least I believed her, a lot of what she said, but that's beside the point. And just as usual, everybody loved it. There were 95% up likes and 95% positive comments. But then I saw a couple comments that concerned me where they were supporting me, they were supporting what I was doing. But I did see a couple comments. I don't want to call them out specifically. I don't want to embarrass anybody, but I do think that I overlooked one really, really important thing. And again, this is nobody's fault. I'm not putting blame on you. This has nothing to do with you as a person. This has to do with the illness, which is that most of my audience are mentally ill. Most of my audience have eating disorders, and most of my audience are in the thick of their eating disorders. And therefore, why wouldn't they make the vote that they want to continue to see Eugenia on my channel? That is feeding into their eating disorder. Now, I'm not saying that if you voted for me to continue to watch Eugenia, that you have an eating disorder or that you have that intent at all. But I will say that it didn't really hit me until last night when I realized that, well, of course, the majority of my audience is going to vote that way because the majority of my audience is sick. And if you're one of those people, please don't take this as me shaming you. This is not your fault. I should have listened to my gut. I should have done
the right thing. Keep showing it. So she was like, okay, I'm doing the right thing. I'm helping. I'm doing the right thing. I'm helping. Mia's wrong. You know, not Mia's wrong about everything, but it's working.
On my videos. I said in my video last night, but I took it down a couple hours after I posted it because I just felt too bad about it. So I had taken it down, but I did say in that video, from here on out, I wasn't going to show Eugenia anymore. I just was going to react to her with her body and face and everything out of the camera, and you would only hear her voice. And I thought that maybe that would be better, but now I'm not so sure that even that would be better, because if Eugenia Cooney is really triggering people that much, then even her voice would trigger them as well. And so I don't want to do that. I don't want to be here to trigger my audience and to make them uncomfortable. And I'm so sorry that I did that.
I'm getting the numbers, I'm getting the views, I'm getting all these things. She doesn't monetize, so she wasn't about the money. It was about people are seeing this, Eugenia's going to see this, and we're going to get her help. She ended up posting a video where she had to have some humble pie. Thought that was funny. I enjoyed that. Thank you for the start of that video. But she also was talking about how, yeah, this didn't work. And the people that were saying yes to seeing Eugenia's content were triggering themselves and were partaking in a form of pro Anna content whilst tricking themselves into believing, well, I'm on a recovery page, it's not that bad. Does that make sense? I don't know how to word that in a better way, but that's what was happening. And that there really, really upset Shani, and she was like, I'm wrong. Like, to all the people that I have triggered and hurt and caused, you know, anything to, I'm sorry. And she was really apologetic about it. And I feel as though at the end of that debacle, I feel as though I am more confident in what Mia had said, because she had said that she's worked with ED strugglers and survivors. She's worked with these people in the depths of the darkest times. She's worked with them. She gets it. She knows it. She's talking about it. And the way that she explained that we can actually help is not the way that we're doing it, which is talking about Eugenia, picking up a box and moving it, picking up a box and moving it, and all this sort of stuff. Like, that's not helping. The way we can actually help is by looking into eating disorders, understand them better, understand how complex they are, and understand that people who are struggling with EDs, it's very, very complex, it's very, very individual, and the best way for them to have the support and the help is by having the funding, the access, the ability to reach these services and to have a supportive network around them. And I don't feel like any of this Eugenia hunt down, whether it is sticking up for her or not sticking up for her, whether it's like yelling at other people for content on her or whether it's putting her down, like none of this is helping. And I agree with that. And that's why when she said about, when Mia said about Pro Anna, I'm like, okay, could Ari, 50 Shades of Chest Pains, be viewed as Pro Anna? Or can it be viewed as just normalizing the topic of eating disorders? Maybe the way he's doing it comes across as villainizing people with eating disorders, and which promotes to the shame and all these other things. See how like there's a like a roller coaster that goes on in my head about these sort of things. My initial goal and thing of doing this big video already was to like rip into this guy because his channel makes me uncomfortable. But instead, what I've come out doing is thinking, okay, I need to understand eating disorders better. I need to not get on my channel and say that this is my opinion on everything because I know everything. No, it's kind of like, okay, we kind of need to educate ourselves a little better and understand a little better what people are actually going through with EDs, and not in the way that I believe this channel is doing it, which comes from a more tinfoil hat, salacious, gossipy, tea time sort of way. I don't know. I guess I just find this channel bizarre. I find the whole idea bizarre and I don't like it. But I'm trying to open my mind a little more. And that leads me to another part of this video. Okay, so in this part, I will be talking about my own faults. Now, this is going to be an apology, in a sense. I had a friend that I was friends with for many, many, many years. And I ended up having a fallout with this friend over a situation that I'm not comfortable talking about publicly. And I probably won't be talking about publicly. But we ended up having a falling out. And whilst for the first maybe 4 or 5 years of our friendship, she was in and out of my life because she didn't like to see me, because I was a drug addict. She did not like to see me pissing my life away, essentially. Poor choice after poor choice. And I respect that. I'm not mad about that. You know, she had her reasons for not wanting to be a witness to those sorts of things, and I respect that. But for the last couple of years of our friendship, it was found out she was struggling with an ED, severely struggling with an ED. And I look back on my participation as her friend, and I feel like I made a lot of mistakes. And I feel like I don't want to cry. I don't want this to make this about me or victim or whatever, but maybe if I can be honest about this, maybe other people can maybe see if they've ever made the same sort of mistakes or try not to make the same mistakes. I made a lot of mistakes of not understanding the core issue of what she was struggling with when it came to eating disorders. I had the naive thought of, I can't change her. I can't change her choices. I can just be supportive and understanding. But instead I was kind of silencing her, I guess, because I never asked any questions about her mental health. I never knew the lower issues of it. I didn't realize that inviting her over for dinner and having a large meal together, and because that's what I do, is I eat a large amount, and I sit back and I chill and, you know, I smoke a little green or something like that and we just relax. Okay, that's what we had done in the past. I didn't realize that I was contributing in that way to fulfilling that need in that moment for her, but later on she was going to feel a certain way and I was not there for her because I didn't understand it. I didn't get it. And I feel really shitty about it, to be honest with you. Not understanding or listening or educating her parents, which is what I could have done if I knew better. Seeing now that she probably doesn't and didn't have a supportive network around her, when I see in a lot of these recovery spaces that that's really important, that makes me feel really, really bad. But I'm gonna end the video here. And let me know what you guys think down below. Any thoughts, feelings, opinions, negative, positive, in between, let me know everything, because this was just a bit of a rambly one where I just wanted to get it all out and get it off my chest, and just let me know what you think. And all the resources will be down below. So anyway, guys, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. Remember to like, subscribe, send a pigeon, keep the same energy. And let me know what you guys want to talk about next. And let me know if you like this longer, more rambly, just talking about things with you guys type of video. Because I do a lot of this on my own and then I end up not making the video because I'm like, oh my God, I'm so conflicted on everything in this. Anyway, guys, bye.